Hi, I'm Dave Gibbons, and everything comes back to 2000 AD.
Greetings, I am Star. I bring you a galactic new comic, 2000 AD, with adventures from the future, including the new invincible Dan Dare. Also a genuine Tardis space spinner, free in 2000 AD now.
Hold it, creep. Isn't I so cute with your name on it? Nobody gets the better of Judge Dredd. Hi-X!
Do you want me to tell you?
No, I can't do that to you.
It's like Fight Club. But the gods of comics gave me a reprieve from that disgraceful behaviour. And I eventually found my way into comics. But I had to essentially teach myself. So I used to buy every book that there was about figure drawing or how to do comics, including the wonderful How to Draw Comics the Marvel Way, which is still one of the best texts ever written about actually doing comics. And I got to know people in the business and looked over people's shoulders. So I'm essentially self-educated. And I still buy books on how to draw, how to do comics. Clearly I know quite a lot of it, but in almost every book there will be some little nugget that you haven't quite seen explained before, you haven't quite thought of before. And so it's been a long-standing wish of mine to sort of put the knowledge that I've learned into the kind of book that would really have helped me if I'd read it when I was trying to break into comics. And so Tim Pilcher, who's has been a friend of mine for a long, long time, and who's written books about the kind of history of comics and has worked editorially in comics, he proposed that we did a book for a British publisher called Rotovision. And I essentially talked to him at some length, and you can imagine what that feels like, about what I'd learned, and he took copious notes and boiled it all down into something that would fit a reasonable sized book. And he trawled my archives, because I'm, as several people in this room know, I hold on to everything, because it might come in handy one day. Yeah. So I had all these roughs and annotated scripts and failed pages and thumbnails and everything. So they also found their way into the book. And it's quite interesting, because some of them I actually find a bit embarrassing, because they're rather old and not particularly well done, but they are a genuine record of my creative process over the years. So that was sort of the motivation of doing the book. The thing that I would stress about doing comics, and it's the thing that's always really appealed to me about comics, and it is the key to anything you might do in a comic book, is it is about storytelling. It's not about draftsmanship, it's not about pretty pictures, it's not about, oh wow, isn't that a lovely picture? Because the minute you look at a picture and think that, you're out of the story. It's only ever been my ambition to draw well enough to tell the story, and there is no point in drawing beyond that. And even more so, I was reading some scientific research about how long people spend looking at a page of a comic book, and I have to tell you, it's a depressingly small number of seconds. So although I want what I draw to be looked at again and again, and would hope that I always do the best I'm capable of, there is the best way to draw comics. It has got a certain economy and a certain conciseness about it, and that's what I'm trying to put over in this book. Yeah, do a lot of research, do as many designs to get it just the way you want it to be. But then the execution of it should be very much with the reader in mind, and with everything done to make the story as clear as possible and the characters as vivid as possible.
When I mean, you talked about absorbing the stuff from all the art books you could possibly find. When did it really click? When did you start to feel as if you were developing your own style, that you were ready to learn comics, or was it very much a journey of progress, you know, each individual step, lots of practice, and then beginning to get your first work?
Well, I mean, I suppose in my social circle, or my family, I was always a good drawer, you know, and you know, I'd show my mum or my dad, and they'd go, oh yeah, that's really good, and my friends would get me to draw funny pictures of school teachers and things, so I sort of thought, yeah, I can draw, you know, with the arrogance and innocence, you think, I'm pretty good, mate, you know. But the absolute pivotal moment was after I'd rediscovered comics, and I was working as a building surveyor. Being a building surveyor involves, I'm sure you have in the States, you've got buildings, you must have buildings surveyor. So,
you know. Or a woman, so, So,
and I'd go to this particularly kind of downbeat part of London where there were lots of, I don't know, would you call them thrift stores or secondhand bookstores? And I'd fill in all the comics that I'd missed over the years when I was more interested in other things. And I always had this kind of ambition, you know, like everybody likes to think they could be famous or they could be a musician or something, that one day I would be a comic book artist. I would draw for DC Comics. But really, living in England, when it was quite clear that American comics, DC in particular, were drawn by, frankly, don't want to offend anybody, the Mafia, you know, because it was Buscema and Infantino and, you know, speak of Tommy Brazil. I thought, there's no way that you ever get into that clothes shop. They're all in New York with their suspenders and their cigars and drink comics. Anyway, one of these comics I picked up was Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Oh, nice.
Number 12 or something. I picked it up. God, this is really badly drawn. This is awful. I could do better than this. And then I flipped to Stan's soapbox, you know, where Stanley would give you his musings. And it said, hey, watch out for the new issue of Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., drawn by young Britisher Barry Smith. Young Britisher. This guy's from England, he's young like me, and he's got a job in Marvel Comics. So all I have to do is prove to them that I can draw better than Barry Smith. They've got to give me a job. That was the logic of it, you know. So I bought some Bristol board, because I figured out by then that comic book art is drawn bigger. I spent all my youth kind of drawing these, which is probably why I have to wear these expensive glasses now. And I redrew the whole thing, and I sort of reconstructed the script from the printed page and drew my own version and tried not to reproduce anything. And I did it. I thought, well, that's it. Well, that, you know, it's as good as what Barry Smith did. I'd sort of, by now I'd lost my arrogance that it was better. So. And I got in touch with an old friend of mine. I'll skip over this bit, but I eventually went to see a guy, an Englishman called Des Skin, who's quite well known in comic book circles. And he worked for Fleetway, who later became the publishers of 2000 AD. And so he took my samples, including this redrawn thing, from me and took it back upstairs to his office, told me that he'd be in touch in a few days, and let me know whether I was good enough for his fanzine, not professional comics, his fanzine. So he took the comics back upstairs and showed them to the guy who was sitting at the next desk. It was a guy called Steve Parkhouse, who was Barry Smith's best friend.
Oh.
And had actually written the story that I'd taken it upon myself to improve. So, you know, I think I learned lesson number one, comics is a very small women's session. It's kind of limited, be very careful. But I became very good friends actually with Steve Parkhouse, and he later would write Doctor Who at the time when I was drawing. And he actually taught me the skill of hand lettering. I literally looked over his shoulder and saw how he would draw the lines out and the kind of pens he would use and the sort of sticky paper that he would do it on. So he was very helpful to me. And then I actually did lettering for Fleetway, and I would be sent every week a big bundle of drawings. A big, I thought it was the police. They found me out at last. So I would be sent other people's artwork to do the lettering on. And of course, that was a wonderful part of my education, because I'd be able to look at the artwork, see the materials they'd use, the scale at which it was done, how you'd have to draw to get a certain look when it was shrunk and reproduced. And that was ended up being tremendously useful. Part of my career. In fairness to Barry Smith, I would have to say that I would consider Barry Smith to be essentially a better draftsman than me. And I've never actually spoken to him about this. But the thing that I would say that is rather weird is I did discover that he and I were born in exactly the same hospital. in London in exactly the same week.
Wow.
And that was kind of weird, whether there was some sort of cosmic fairy, perhaps fairy is a wrong word, a cosmic spirit of comic greatness, you know? Or maybe we got swapped, and maybe in fact in another universe, I'm Dave Windsor Gibbons. So, anyway.
One thing I'm always fascinated about, particularly with people who learn to draw in the pre-digital age, is how much the mechanics of doing comics influenced your style. Yeah. Because you know when you're drawing, when you're using pencils and inks, there are shortcuts that inform the way that you do things. How much of your style is an expression of the physical way that you make comics?
Yeah, I mean that's quite interesting, isn't it? I mean, most of the stuff I do nowadays, and you know, I'm a mature gentleman, and I'm best used in a supervisory role these days. But I mean, most of the work that I do digitally. I draw it on a Wacom tablet, Cintiq, where it magically, as you draw, the lines appear underneath. In fact, the poster we've got at the booth is completely digital.
Yeah, $30.
It's a limited edition, and it's I still draw in the same way that I used to draw when I was drawing in analog, or whatever you like to call it. And what is lost is not only the fact you no longer have an original to sell, but there is a certain tactile pleasure in drawing on a piece of paper. It's strange. There's something about the resistance of it. There's something about the noise that the nib makes and the way the paper absorbs the ink that I kind of miss. But there's so much convenience to doing stuff digitally. Once you've done it, it's kind of hard to go back because there are so many shortcuts. But yeah, I mean, you know, say in Watchmen, there are lots of street scenes which rely on me being able to draw buildings in two-point perspective. And if any of you draw anything you've ever tried to do, you have to draw all these guidelines and measure things out to arrive at a final drawing that looks as if it's something that can convincingly exist in three-dimensional space. So I know how to do that. On the computer, I just go click and set a vanishing point, click, and every line I draw will be in the perfect perspective.
Wow.
And that's a tremendous time saver. But if I hadn't done it the old way, I wouldn't realize what a wonderful gift it was. And I probably would have just taken what the computer gave me rather than impose the way I wanted it to look. And I also know how to not be a slave to the computer, how to finesse it and how to dodge it to get the effect I want.
Is there ever a time you feel that there's something lacking in digital art? You say sometimes you ignore what the computer's saying. Have you ever looked at something you've done on the Wacom and thought, it's not the soul that I wanted it to have?
I think there is a danger though, but I mean, you know, even leaving computers aside, if you've ever drawn, you're always in search of the magic pen point. You know, when you speak to an artist, you like, what sort of pen do you use? And they say, I use a Hunt 103. You go, great. If I can get a Hunt 103, I can draw like them. But really, the Hunt 103 is just a tool. People used to use the airbrush a lot in commercial illustration. For a while, everything had to be airbrushed. And then everybody realized that you didn't have to airbrush anything. But it was a very useful tool to have when you needed that particular effect to get in. And then there was the Zippertone, you know, the black dots that look like grey when they're printed. We used to use that everywhere. All the wonderful fade-out effects and all this. And then you think, well, actually, I only needed to use it there, really. And you calm down about it. And the same happens with the computer. At first, you're dazzled by all the magic it can do at the click of a button. A perfect gradient in the background. A perfect blend between 20 colours. And then you think, yeah, you know, it's the tool is using me rather than me using the tool. You have to remember that for all its wonders, all the computer is a tool to be used as your brain directs. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. I think one of the things I'm fascinated, because you have a very distinctive style, but one that appears to be very adaptable. So you have incredible dense storytelling or something like Watchmen. You have the very action-orientated stuff like Rogue Trooper. There's a great emotional weight to things like Washington and reinventing stuff that you did as well. How much of that is that you found an easy way to do a process and it was useful and it worked, and how much of it was conscious?
Right. Well, I suppose, you know, because I have got a sort of a scientific education, building surveying, I guess, is a technical thing and it's a structural thing. I do tend to work in a structural way. You know, the kind of classic thing of doing a thumbnail sketch so that you've got an idea of how everything's going to fit, and then do a rough where you compose it to make it a good composition, and then you refine that and you add, you know, anatomy and perspective and all those things to get a drawing that you can then confidently draw in permanent ink on. And I've always found that if you follow a process, you can get a consistent result. Some people think it sounds very restrictive, that what an artist should do is just, I'll throw it down on the paper and let it come out and be creative. But I've actually found that's the path to heartache, really, you know. That you can, if you've got a system, you know how many pages you can draw a week. You know how to get consistent results. And, you know, if you're having a bad day, the drawing isn't so good, but if it's just part of a bigger job where you've had good days, and you're inking it on a different day than the day you had the bad day drawing it, it all kind of smooths out anyway. So I found to have a system is a really good way to do things consistently. Was that a question you asked me?
Not quite.
No. I suspected it was.
One thing you'll be, that's said, you know, your style is very unique. You know, how much was that you going, well, I want to draw in this particular way? How much of it was just because that's the way you make comics?
Yeah, I mean, I've always liked to vary my style, and I suppose it is part of having a strategic look at something, and again, looking at the system. What do you want the overall feel of this thing to be before you even start? And something like Watchmen, I knew was going to be a very complicated story, so I suggested that we do it on a 9-panel grid, so we could really densely pack the information in there, because that was exactly what it was like, and it was supposed to feel claustrophobic and supposed to feel methodical and metronomic, and so that worked for that. Something like Martha Washington was like an explosive, crazy science fiction adventure, so it didn't want to be done on the grid, it wanted to have this different page, it wanted to have gorgeous colour rather than quite muted colour. So I always would start by taking a strategic view, and when it comes to the covers and things, to have a certain typographic, you know, or rather graphic look to it, you know, and choose the fonts very carefully. And so I've always sort of done that. And I suppose I like to think of myself as versatile. I mean, I've drawn quite grim stuff, but to begin with, I used to draw humorous stuff. You know, breeders used to send in jokes on postcards, and I would draw the jokes in a sort of a Bigfoot, big nose, wacky kind of style, and I quite enjoy doing that. And sometimes I have to pull myself away from being humorous. Sometimes I have to, you know, it's like me trying to keep a straight face. I draw this very, very seriously. So I do like the variety of working, but my basic system would always be the same, you know, thumbnails, roughs, pencils, inks, letters, colour, same.
You used the word earlier, which was draftsman.
Yeah.
And for me, that people can still be a draftsman even when they're using digital tools, but that always brings to my mind the age of, you know, Bristol board and ink and pencils and whiteout and whatnot. You learned to draw and you began your career when things were still very physical, when you were still producing actually. And we were talking earlier about how you went down to the DC Thompson archive, and there's like your first page in there that you drew, because they still keep it. Do you feel privileged to have had that? Because so many people, there's not the industry to support people making mistakes in print, I think.
Oh yeah, that's true. I mean, I was very lucky to break into comics when I did, and actually there were a lot of people who did break in at a similar time to me, because in England, it was the people who were fans of American comics were all of a certain age. The import of American comic books into Great Britain was stopped in the early 50s because there was this whole horror comics thing. And apparently Winston Churchill stood up in the House of Parliament with a copy of Tales from the Crypt, complaining about this American garbage that was coming to our shores. And you know, it was this horrible Americanization of culture. And interestingly enough, in the States, politicians held up comics saying that they were part of the march of communism. You know, that they were trying to kill the American way of life. So, you know, there was always this sort of scapegoating. And certainly when I was at school, they literally burned comic books. They literally would confiscate comic books and burn them. And interestingly enough, I think you may have heard, this is another one of my seminal moments. I remember standing out in the schoolyard while one of the prefects, you know, like one of the older kids, walked out with a pile of comics and walked past me. And I was heartbroken. I wasn't heartbroken because any of my comics were being destroyed. It's clear they're much too valuable to take to school. Or in fact, that the general notion of these comics being burned, to be honest. But the worst thing about it was the top comic on the pile was another Green Lantern comic. And it was Green Lantern number 6, where we first meet Tomar Ray, who's the parrot-faced Green Lantern of the planet Zuba. So I'm sure most of the people in this room are aware.
And raise your hands. Oh, it's good smattering.
Yeah. And the thing was that I didn't have that comic, and there it was going. that was the tragedy of it. But anyway, I grew up on American comics, which were started to be re-imported into Britain in 1959. So if you were of a young comic reading age then, you got the full mainline stuff from the States. People like myself and Brian Bolland and Kevin O'Neill, Mick McMahon and other people to a certain extent were of that generation, and we were lucky enough to be around when things like 2000 AD were being created, and it was the perfect vehicle for us to get our work into print and to give a slightly more American feel to what had been quite a staid kind of comic book industry. But the other point you make is quite right. There were so many comics in those days. The average British comic would be, I don't know, 32 pages with maybe 7 or 8 different stories in it. So there was space to try out new writers and artists, and it was much easier to get in, even doing menial jobs like lettering or cleaning artwork. So, and we were at the tail end of people who'd spent their life doing it and were able to pick the brains of people who had this tremendous kind of knowledge of how you did comics and all the really arcane things about comics that you'd never suspect until you're actually in the business. I think I brought you around in a circle now.
Yeah, that's absolutely fine. So, it's nice that you brought us onto to 2000 AD and mentioned Green Lantern as well, because you were the artist on Dandare, the 2000 AD reboot of Dandare, which was a character that you had great fondness of when you were a child. You also had great fondness of Green Lantern. You got to work on Green Lantern. Was that something were these things that landed in your lap, or did you strive to do them? Was it happenstance? Was it chance? Was it determination that you got to work on the characters that you loved the most?
Yes. I mean, you had to be in the right place at the right time. When 2000 AD first started, they did a new version of Dandare. Dandare had been in comics in the 50s in England, and he was essentially a sort of World War II airman translated to the space station. All the uniforms looked like Royal Air Force uniforms. Wow. And Dan was a jolly good chap, and, you know, very British and very aristocratic, with a bumbling servant who would get into trouble with all the aliens and everything like that. But it was a beacon of brightness in science fiction in the times when I was growing up. And I found myself working for 2000, and their first reboot of Dandare just didn't really work. And they asked me to have a go at it, and I couldn't say anything else other than yes. And so I thought, I can bring back the Mekon. He was this alien who was Dandare's arch enemy, and I can do this. So I did all these sketches and took them into the publishers and said, look, I'll do it like this. And they went, no, we've already decided what it's going to look like. The first script's been written. He's this militaristic character, and he's got this space ford, and he's going to go around killing aliens. So he's going, oh, okay, but I still couldn't say no. So I slaved away on that, and in fact, this may be of interest. the creator of Down There, a guy called Frank Hampson, had been really badly treated by the publishers, and he was quite a bitter man. And I met him, I was introduced to him by somebody else, and they said, "Oh, Frank, this is Dave Gibbons. He draws Down There for 2008. Oh my God. So I held out my hand and said, "Oh, it's a huge pleasure to meet you, Frank. I'm really sorry that I can't do justice to your work. That's all right, old son. We all have to make a living." And I thought that was so gracious of him. And it actually,
I think one of the things that loops back, talking about Watchmen, loops back to what we're talking about, about storytelling, because as you said, Watchmen is all about the storytelling. It's packed with information, and possibly one of the reasons why people are so fascinated by it is because it begs the imagination to fill in the gaps and fill in the rest of this world. So let's talk about storytelling. We've already mentioned how important it is. What for you are the keys to good storytelling in the comics? I don't like that grin you just had.
Well, I just actually, one thing I would just like to add while we're in the shameless plug of this tool, is that I'm not completely against having anything to do with Watchmen, and there are some publications which I consider are very honourable and are part of the Watchmen canon, including I've recently been giving some assistance to a gentleman who's in this room, Mr. Leslie Klinger, who has done the gentleman at the front in the green shirt, who is a great scholar of the various worlds of fantasy and characters from Dracula to Sherlock Holmes to the annotated Sandman. And he's produced a wonderful work called The Annotated Watchman, which is full of detail and interesting observations on what Alan and I did in Watchmen. And it's certainly the most comprehensive and informed analysis of the work that I've seen, and I think it's a really good companion to those of you who crave more Watchmen material. And I believe it's out towards the end of the year.
End of November.
It's out towards the end of November. From DC. So, yes, I don't hate DC and I don't hate Watchmen, but I don't love all of it.
So that's the question, yeah.
What's the question again?
What for you are the keys to good storytelling in comics?
The keys to good storytelling, clarity. I mean, it's got to, you mustn't make people struggle for it. It's like having a movie where you can't hear the soundtrack, or having a novel written in gibberish, or written in, you know, some obscure way, much like this answer. It is clarity. It is a graphic medium, so it's much better to show things than to tell them in words. There are certain basic key things. From when I first broke into comics, you have to have variety on the page. You can't have what you can. So when you say you can and you can't with art, you're in difficult trouble anyway. But it makes for a less interesting page if all the figures are the same size, for instance. So it's good to vary the shots. It's good to think about it in a cinematic way, that you have a moving camera rather than a proceeding arch effect. You have to have consistency. In other words, you have to recognize the characters from panel to panel and make sure that you draw them in such a way that you're never in any doubt who the characters are, even if they're only drawn in silhouette, for instance. I suppose what it is really is reading comics. You know, just like you learn to write novels or whatever by reading novels, you learn how to do comic storytelling by reading comics. If you've ever come to a bit in a comic where you've lost the plot, then it's really the thing to work out why you've lost the plot and never do that in your own work. So, you know, I could, without a little provocation, talk for hours and hours, but it is clarity and it is, again, telling the story. That's what the art of comics is. It isn't the drawing, it's the story.
We're coming down to the end of the panel, I want to have time for some questions, but just on that point, you are one of the actually few artist writers in sort of big mainstream comics. If it's on the 2008 panel yesterday, you were talking about the slightly odd relationship you had with Jerry Finley Day's scripts on Road Trooper. You've written your own and drawn your own comics. As I said, that is a very rare thing to find, because so often artists maybe the structure of the scripts, and usually other writers can't draw. What did you find provoked you into writing and stuff?
Well, when I was growing up, I mean, there weren't fanzines, there wasn't the internet, there weren't comic conventions, and I thought that comic strips were drawn and written by the same person. And some of them were. Very, very few of them. I mean, I didn't realise the kind of, you know, American comics have their roots in the garment business, so it's basically one person makes the pants, the other makes the jacket, there's a presser, there's a stitcher, that's the production line, and a page pops out at the end. So all the stuff I did growing up, I'd write my own story and illustrate it. And when I came to break into comics, that's what I really wanted to do. But of course, when you've worked editorially in comics, you can look at a page of artwork and say yes or no. If you want to evaluate a script, you've got to read it, and that takes time. So the early work I got was drawing, and I was able to do that. And I've been particularly lucky in my career to work with some wonderful, wonderful writers. Obviously, Alan Moore, Frank Miller, Pat Mills, John Waitner. I mean, just amazing writers who I've learned a lot from, and I've been really happy to draw their scripts. Occasionally, you'll get a script that isn't quite so good, and it's a very dispiriting process to have to spend weeks drawing something that somebody's bashed out in a couple of hours. So one of the great benefits of watching me becoming successful is all of a sudden my name seemed to acquire what I believe they call in Hollywood a marquee value. Yeah. You know, if my name was there, then people would go, oh, Watchman, yeah. You know, even if it was just some fairly rubbish bit of writing in the back of a British comic. So I got offered lots of work then as a writer. And I think, again, you know, I wouldn't want to blow my own trumpet as much as I did in the Barry Smith case, but I thought, yeah, I can do this, and it was quite well received. And again, I was really lucky there to work with people like Mike Mignola, Jose Luis Garcia Lopez, Steve Rude, who just took my scripts and just transformed them. And it was interesting to be on the other side of the fence and to see what a good writer, what a good artist could add to a script, you know. And what I probably added to a script in the times, you know. So I eventually did write and draw my own comic book, which was called The Originals, which was a kind of semi-autobiographical thing of me growing up. If you want a full story on that, I suggest you follow me to my next panel, which is Berger Books, where Karen Berger has a new line of books coming out, and we're doing an oversized, high-quality reprint of the originals. But I did actually, having been a collaborator for so many years, I actually found it much more difficult than I thought. Because I didn't have anybody to bounce ideas off. And I'd sit there thinking, does anybody in the whole world except me care about this? Oh. And it was actually, I'm really glad I did it, but it was quite difficult creatively, because it was just me. And my wife was very tolerant and understanding with me during the long, grim months. But I must say, and this will sound like a self-serving story, but I think it probably ties it off, it was great that she was with me in San Diego when it was nominated for and actually won an Eisner Award. And in that moment, for that moment, for me at least, I don't think still for her, it seemed worthwhile. So I love to collaborate. I think all my best work really has been in collaboration with other people, and that is the best state to be in, where it's two minds with a single thought, and you come up with stuff you never come up with on your own. So I like to, it's not I like to write or I like to draw, I like to collaborate.
Well, one final question. You've named an incredible list of people who've worked in Western comics there, and you've clearly reached a stage in your career where you wanted to impart your knowledge with Tim Pilcher. What else is there to do for you? What is next? What's a new frontier, a new challenge for you now?
I think, I'm still interested in technology. I'm particularly interested in storytelling technology. I've been involved with a company called Madefire, who do what we call motion books. These things have yet to find their correct names, although I must say, in all their history, comic books have never actually been comic books. You know, But they're comics that you can read on an iPad or Android device, which uses the kind of smart paper capabilities to tell stories. I'm also involved with another company called Magic Leap, who have some amazing mixed reality technology, which I can guarantee is going to be ubiquitous in the years to come. And again, there's all sorts of storytelling possibilities there. And yeah, I do like to teach as well. I enjoy the process of teaching. And indeed, in the course of doing this book with Tim, I've actually discovered that I know things that I didn't know I knew. So that's kind of rewarding. And I must say, the older I get, the less inclined I am to not spend long hours at the drawing board. But I still like to keep my hand in. I've done the poster for 2000 AD, and I do bits here and there. But generally, I think my skills and my enthusiasm is best directed towards jobs of supervisory nature.
Excellent. Well, we've got a few minutes left. If you would like to ask Dave Gibbons a question, there's a microphone in the middle of the room. There's a bit nervous.
You know they have to leave, right? Go
home. Okay. 2018, inspiring new deadly futures. The thing is, he said, it interferes with my psychic abilities. Give it a go.
It interferes with my psychic abilities.
You volunteered for this? Okay, fine. Next volunteer. What's the attraction of, you say that the various properties that you're looking at the moment. What's the attraction for Iron Globe or something like Jojo? Because, I'm going to play devil's advocate here. We had Stallone movie. Thank you for the unprompted reaction to that. I didn't want to say anything, but, I can feel the temperature in the room drop. But then obviously we had the excellent Dread movie, which didn't do as well as we hoped, even though it had an amazing reaction. So what's the value of something like Joe Strait's Wine Blow? Aside from obviously something that you can produce and sell and make money out of, obviously.
That's really cynical, man.
Very much so. I said, I've been devil's advocate here.
I think it's amazing. It's an amazing world. The coolest thing about Dread for me is, well, there's a couple of amazing things about it. One is, it's so relevant to today. Unfortunately, it's even more relevant to today, and especially the world we live in now, than ever. So it was a satire 20, 30 years ago. It's even more actually real now. And that's cool, right? When you can do something that relates to the world and comments on the world, but in a heightened way. It's also a world, it is such a cool, interesting world filled with all sorts of people and this great mythology. And you come in through Dread, but the cool thing about Megacity One that Brian Jenkins and Chris and Jason are doing is, it's called Megacity One for a reason. It's actually the world of Dread. Dread's definitely in it. And I have a big announcement about Carl Urban that I'd like to make. Which is, I have no idea if it's going to be it yet.
That was really cool. I said something. I swear I didn't tell him to do that.
Yes, you did.
Yeah, I said
I will say about Carl, yes, of course we would love him to be in the series. We're talking to him about it. I think that we have to kind of figure it out first. We're very at the early stages of the whole process. They're trying to figure out exactly what the series is going to be and how it's going to work. It is Megacity One, it's not Judge Dredd, so even though Dredd is definitely in the series and it plays an important part in it, it's an ensemble drama about a group of judges. And so we have to kind of figure out what he wants to do and how he fits into that, and then, believe me, you guys will be the first to know when we know anything real. Well, I'm sure of that. You'll know before we know, actually. Sure, we all over the blocks. But I'm really off topic for it. What was I talking about?
I was just enjoying the ride, man.
It's been a while since I've been on a panel.
So in terms of your hopes for the look and feel of it, both Jason and Brian on the videos on YouTube and also on the podcast talked about their hopes of kind of striking a balance between the kind of more realistic.
Oh,
We are definitely going to have to procure. There's definitely, and what's cool about them, we'll say what's really interesting about what these guys are doing, because they are starting to break the stories for season one, is it's focused on, as I said, these judges, and some of them are seasoned and some of them are newbies. But then they're also kind of breaking away for some flashback episodes. They're doing some kind of three-episode arc episodes. So they're really trying to kind of fill out other characters, including Dredd, and kind of give you some background in terms of how this world kind of became what it is.
Thank you. Okay, thanks for your question. Thanks.
So this is a question for Dave. Working with a magazine like 2000 AD, where the stories are so long running and they go on for decades, what was your personal experience with rebooting one of those characters so late afterwards?
Well, it's kind of difficult when you reboot anything, because I think my story suggested there are lots of people who like it just the way it is. And to be quite honest with you, I think I was being slightly indulged. I think for the reasons that I said, they wanted to have my name on it. They said, I'll be able to do whatever you like, really, Dave. So it is a problematic thing to do. Probably better to put one's efforts into creating new characters.
And final question.
I can't talk about it. For Mark, really, actually, it's kind of a few questions, but just quickly, do you think doing a TV series, which sounds amazing, kills the possibility of additional movies down the road, or do you think just at bottom line, it's finances, and the finances of the last movie kind of killed any further Dredd movies down the road?
That's really a 2008 question, but I will say, I personally don't think so, because they're not doing a Dredd series, right? So even though Dredd's in it, you're really doing a series that fills out the world, which certainly leaves room for additional movies that kind of take that character in other direction, though.
Can I ask one other question? There's some of the things with the details, you know, fans are crazy, of course, but with some of the things, like in the Dredd movie, like the moment when they're going up the stairs with the smoke bombs and they put their little respirators in like this, you know, couldn't they just have done that? How hard was it? Some of those little details that people are kind of really looking for, do you think it's money that stops people doing that, or is it, could you just need CGI doing things? Could you have the bikes look more like the original bikes? Or is it just an artistic opportunity to take it in a different direction?
Well, you know, here's the cool thing about this series, I think, versus the film. And Jason and Brian and Chris were really careful to hold on very close to the material, right? The movie kind of got away from them, I think, in feature films well, especially big, expensive ones. And I think there were definitely things as, they're the original fanboys, right? So I think there are things in the movie that maybe they, I don't want to speak for them, but that they wanted to do differently.
Yeah.
And I certainly know that the way that they're designing the series is very much with the fans in mind, because they're the fans. So I think those kinds of discrepancies, the small things that other people might not notice, but people that really love this property are going to really care about, are definitely going to be things that they care about too.
I was in. I know the girl was agoraphobic. I said we went out.